Alrighty, so we have a packed agenda, so I'm just gonna go ahead and get started. So welcome everybody. This is developing a sales strategy that works for your startup or small business. Welcome everybody. It's nice to see, you know, all of you who are back. I see some familiar faces, but I also see some new ones. So my name is Anya Lehmann, Innovation Director here at Ascender. Again, if this is not your first time, welcome back. If this is your first time, we're really happy that you're here. And kudos to you already for making it happen. We have a lot prepared for you in order to really improve yourselves and walk away with a tangible, with tangible skills, but also a plan of action that you can implement for your business. As you may know, Ascender is Pittsburgh's community for entrepreneurs. We offer educational programs, mentorship, expert coaching, business incubation, and run an entrepreneur-focused co-working space near Bakery Square. So as you all know, it's the summer, you know, we're all feeling a little bit more comfortable with each other, hanging out a little bit more at different networking events and whatnot. So it is a great time to reconnect with the entrepreneurial community. So to get you back in the group, we are offering a limited number of free day passes to try out our co-working space in East Liberty, to get to know our members and also to just hang out with us, with the Ascender team. So if you are interested, we will be putting information on how to redeem that day pass with a special code for you. So make sure that you look that one up in the chat box. As you all know, every month we cater a variety of events and also resources, templates, and videos for you around a particular topic. So this month we are tackling sales and our theme is called Close the Deal. So we really want to get you prepared into thinking about how do you think about your sales strategy? How does that look like? How can you put it into a plan of action? But also how can we expose you to tools and techniques that can really help you grow and scale? And all of this in an effort to really making sure that you are building a sustainable business. So today's session will focus on that in regards to strategy, coming up with a plan of action. How do you think about your sales funnel? And then our next event at the end of the month on July 27th, will focus a little bit more on the technical piece. Now that you have a plan, how can you actualize it using a tool? So we are inviting and featuring HubSpot, a representative from HubSpot for Startups, and Jack Ekblad will be running an engaging session. So make sure that you sign up for the next event. We are really designing and curating events that are complementary and that will make sure that complementary to each other and that will make sure to get you a more well-rounded view about how do you really tackle your sales strategy and make it happen. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our guest speaker today, Steve Kelly. He is the president of ExSELLyst, a local affiliate of Sandler Training. With over 30 years of strategic marketing, sales, engineering, and training experience, his passion is to help customers excel. So I'm gonna let Steve tell us a little bit more about himself and also get us started with the workshop. If you have any questions, please feel free to also always share them with us in the chat box. And Ben and I will be answering as much as possible. But now it's time to get into the workshop. So I'll let you, Steve, get us started.
Great, thank you, Anya. Welcome everybody. Especially welcome at 4:07 on Tuesday, I think it is. Your world's like mine, you're still trying to figure out what day of the week it is and figure out what's going on. And you know, at the end of a day that you all probably started at pre-7:30. I appreciate that you're here. I'm gonna try to keep this as lively and moving at a fast pace. Just because I know at the end of the day, it takes a lot of energy to get up and moving. And frankly, when we start talking about prospecting and selling and putting all the plans together, I know that energy is really important to that. So we're going to go ahead and clip through the presentation. In the chat, you will see access to a document that we're going to be referencing throughout the talk. It's a document you can use to kind of take some notes. It's also a document that you can use later on to really fill it in and work with it. So I want to put that there. I also want to warn you up front, And I apologize. It's a shortcoming of mine that I've had for a very long time. I try to always put in too much into the time frame that we have. So I'm warning you now, we're going to move fast and we're going to cover a lot of material with the expectation that we're going to give you a view of how to do some things and then put you on your way to getting them done. Okay, so couple things, right? For sales strategy, and I know some of you on the screen, I know some people, I recognize some faces. This isn't your first time you've been out selling. So some of this you might think, well, that's pretty straightforward. Believe it or not, for some people it's a challenge. And so I want to touch on some key topics. But when it comes to sales strategy, it's really pretty straightforward, honestly. It's about talking to the right people, knowing who the right person is to start with, or persons, knowing where to find them, and then having a strategy to take action. And it's probably that last piece that most people struggle with, that taking action when it comes to going out and finding the business. I guarantee every one of you has a passion for your business. You have a passion for what it is you do, the product you make, the technology you've developed, whatever it is, I guarantee you have a passion for it. What you probably have less of a passion for is going out and cold calling or prospecting or something else that requires selling that idea or getting your business running. And so we're going to deal with that. And it's that take action piece that I think is the hardest part, but a part we can put some framework around to help you drive it forward. To put this in perspective, right, from a selling perspective of what we're talking about, we're really talking about how do you find people? How do you get a conversation started? We're not talking about how do you sell them or qualify them or how do you then deliver. We're really talking about this first piece of your customer's journey. How do you find them? How do you get them into the process, into your funnel? And that really gets us to our first exercise of the day, the first breakout. I'm going to put you in two breakout groups, or more importantly, Ben and I are going to put you in two breakout groups. Here's what I want. When you go out looking for customers and looking for prospects, how do you do it? Is it random rational design or is it random discover? I work with a lot of small businesses, right? And sometimes they have a very targeted focus. Here's what I'm going for and nothing else. And sometimes it's we'll take whatever we can get. So my question for you is, as you look at your business and what you're doing, where on the spectrum do you fall? And I'm guessing we all fall on a certain spectrum. So go in your breakout groups, come up with a consensus of where most people are, and be prepared with a spokesperson for your breakout group to share with us kind of what you come up with. All right, so very clear. First thing you always have to do is pick a spokesperson, because I guarantee if you don't, you'll forget that part when you come back. Pick a spokesperson, and where are you when it comes to what kind of customers you're going after? Is it very targeted, very, very specific, or is it kind of whatever we can find or somewhere in between? All right, so Ben, if you don't mind, push them on. Perfect. Now let's see if you pass the first test of the day. First test of the day is that you actually pick the spokesperson. So group one spokesperson. You mind coming off mute and talking to me for a second?
What group are we, guys?
Are we group one? Sorry.
Okay, well, I think we're group two.
Here, who you are, which group? If you're a spokesperson, talk to me.
Okay. Group two, yes.
Okay, perfect. What do you got?
Both. So basically everybody has a focus while having a wild card in there. So it may be, you know, exactly who the people I'm looking for, but I'm very broad in terms of location, or I'm very broad in terms of message because I want to reach the very specific people and I don't know them. So
there's a focus of some kind, but there's also this idea of what you said, a wild card, that, hey, if it's out there and they talk to me, I'm going to talk to them.
Yep.
Did you get a sense of how clear the focus was?
Very clear. For many of us, it was very, very clear down to the sector and like the role in an organization and what a person does.
Perfect. Yeah. What about the other group spokesperson? What'd you come up with?
I'll take it group one since I went last. So we had some individuals that were very focused and others that had made attempts to find their salespeople, but then learned that they were incorrect in their initial judgments. So kind of across the spectrum. And then one group also considering a Kickstarter to help them define who their actual sales population or purchasing population would be.
Well, deciding. Got it. Okay, for the spokespersons, or anybody really, if you want to chat your answer, why is this important? We're talking about prospecting. Why is this important? What do you think?
So we don't waste time.
Waste time. How do you waste time?
Being on the internet.
Waste time chasing things that maybe you shouldn't be chasing, right?
You're also wasting the people you talk to, their time.
Yeah, you could be wasting their time too. What's our most precious commodity? Time, right? We care about what we're targeting because if we don't get very specific, it gets to be very hard to know if in this big stack of hay I have in front of me, when I'm talking to somebody, am I holding a needle? Or am I holding a piece of straw? At the end of the day, part of what we're trying to figure out is, what needles am I looking for? How do I know when I have the needle in my hand? And how do I know when I don't so that I can quickly get rid of it and move on to the next, right? So we ask, because we want to make sure we're thinking about the customers or the people we're trying to chase. By the way, we're going to do a lot of breakouts. That's probably the only breakout, I think, where we have big groups. The rest of the time when you're in a breakout, you're going to have a chance to interact with the other people in the breakout. I would highly suggest you take a minute or 30 seconds, introduce yourself, get to know them a little bit. It's a great way to network with people. By the way, it's a great way to prospect. It's a great way for you to prospect at the same time. So having your ideal client profile, we like to think of it as small, medium, and large. Right? Pick whatever set of acronyms you can think of. We often use rabbits, deer, and elephants, right? Small, medium, large. And we do that because we're trying to get a sense of what's the right mix for our business. Some of your businesses may not be able to handle more than one big elephant at a time. Some of you might not be able to handle more than a few rabbits. If we're not careful about what we're focusing on, what that ideal client looks like, we might find ourselves chasing the wrong prospects at the wrong time for the place where we are in our development. So it's important that you take a second to think about what those things are. And just to give you a sense of the definitions, right? A rabbit is simple, easy, they fit. They're not a lot of revenue, but they're easy. And they're gonna create other rabbits for you. They're gonna find other people just like themselves, and they can create a lot of rabbits, a lot of small revenue business. They're not gonna replace one elephant. They're gonna be just easy to go along. Low revenue, easier to close. You have the deer that are more the mid-sized opportunities that you can manage. You can manage a deer, you can manage a couple opportunities like that and have a right mix of it. Lastly, the really big ones are the ones that if you're not careful, you can spend a lot of time chasing a big elephant thinking, oh, that's all I need to make my year and never get it, right? And if you don't get it, you spend a lot of time chasing it. And sometimes even when you get it, it's a problem. So what the right mix is for your business, I don't know. But part of what you want to start to think about is what is the right mix of my business? Because just knowing what kind of customer I want isn't enough. You have to know really what the ideal customer looks like, right? And there's just one other customer I want you to think about, and that's the squirrel. The squirrel is the one that you'd probably be better off firing as a customer, but you took it because it was revenue. Pay attention to which of your customers are squirrels. They're hard to deal with. They don't create a lot of revenue. And in the long run, they may not be helping you very much at all. So actually, I think I lied. I think, no, this is a smaller version. Here's what I want you to do. For your business, I want you to, in your breakout groups, take your ideal customer, right? So we all have a lot of people that have some focus, and define what it means to be a rabbit, an elephant, or a squirrel for your business, right? Take some time with your groups. So you're gonna have a couple minutes in groups of three. There's a page in your workout sheet that you can help use to take notes, right? And take a minute and think about what are the rabbits in my business? What are the deer? What are the elephants? And which ones do I have to stay away from? So go out to your breakout group. When you come back, we'll just take one or two examples so that we have a sense of what they look like. But use the sheet to help you guide you what you're supposed to come up with. And use your breakout partners to think through it logically. Okay, Ben, go ahead and send them out. Hey, welcome back. By the way, as you guys are starting to get the hang of it, a lot of individual work, a lot of work back and forth. I'm also going to warn, let's see, David's still there. Yeah, David's there. Hi, David. Good to see you. David, start thinking of a song. Start thinking of a song. You'll know why in a minute. Here's the thing. How did that go? Did you guys get a chance to really think about what are my rabbits? What are the easy ones I want to go after? How many of those do I need? How many elephants do I need? How many deer do I need? And maybe just importantly, which of the squirrels do I need to kind of get rid of? So hopefully you took a second. If you thought about it and you came up with something really innovative, chat it away. Ben will read it off for us, or Anya will. But that's the first step of this process, right? It's knowing what the groups break down to. What am I looking for? What am I chasing? Right? But that's only the first piece of this. The real detailed piece of this gets into then how do I profile that rabbit, that deer, that elephant even further? How do I really understand? And so what we're going to do is we're going to do some individual work. I'll explain what it is in a second. We're going to do some individual work on one of the three. Right? Just pick one of the three. Don't try to do them all. You should do them all, but we're going to pick one of the three. And then I'm going to have, after your individual work, I'm going to have you share that with one of your co-me people and sense check it with each other. So you can't just skate on this and pretend you're writing, right? Because you're going to have to explain something in a minute. But I want you to take a second and think about the idea of profiles. Now, you'll notice in the document that we sent, there's two pages worth of stuff. You can't do two pages in 5 minutes, not do it justice. And you'll notice that when we talked about rational design or random discovery, everybody, when they talked about what they had, they said, well, we know the demographics, we know the geography, we know the location, maybe we knew the size of the company, those kinds of things. What I want you to focus on for this breakout isn't all that demographic stuff. I want you to focus on what's the business pain or the business frustration that you're trying or your service or product can help them with, right? It's the pain and impact of that pain to their business. If you haven't spent a ton of time thinking about that, you really need to get it and articulate it so that it's very clear this is the business problem we're trying to solve. So as you think about your client profile, think of that piece. What's the business problem? What's the frustration? In Sandler, we say people buy emotionally. They only justify the decision intellectually later. So what is the business frustration that occurs? How would you articulate it? And when you articulate it, what I want you to do is I want you to write it as if you heard one of your prospects or customers saying it to you. So I'll just, David and I know each other, so I'll just use David for a second. David might say, you know what my big business impact is? Our company's missing meetings. We're missing meetings because the way we schedule them with our prospects isn't working. And we can't afford to miss meetings because it's causing us revenue. That's a business pain. So that's what I want you to write down in your profile. Just as importantly though, is what's the personal pain? Man, if I keep missing my sales number, if I keep missing these appointments, what boss is gonna fire me? Again, the personal pain that your prospect, your main decision maker is going through, or likely is going through, or could be going through. Again, from them, and express it the way they would express it with the same kind of frustration. The last piece is, what's a trigger event for you? What's something that's going to take this as a medium priority to, this is a hot item. This is a hot item for me. Those are the three things in your ideal client profile I want you to focus on. So you're going to take the next 5 minutes and work on those three pieces, especially. They're the parts that are in blue on the template, if you're using the template. And now, David, I gave you plenty of time to pick a song. While you're working, you're going to hear a song in the background. Feel free to turn your screen off if that's easier. And when you finish, turn your screen back on. David, I need a song, though.
Well, I was thinking about Happy by Pharrell.
Okay, let me try it. Alexa, play Happy by Pharrell. All right, let me turn the music up. Start working.
So this is three of us supposed to kick back our ideas to one another. Is that what we're supposed to be doing?
Not yet. That's next. First, I want you to individually figure your stuff out. And then we're going to send you, once you have time to do your own, then we're going to go to breakout groups and you'll have time to work with your individual partners. But I want you to spend some of your own time first thinking about it. Alexa, pause. I have no idea how long that was, but it felt like 5 minutes. I'm just glad he didn't pick Freebird or we'd still be listening. Here's what we're going to do now. I want you to work in with your partner. You'll get put into a breakout with a partner. Explain to them, if you're working on a rabbit, explain what the rabbit is. If you're working on a deer, same, elephant, same. Explain what it is, and then explain the business impact to them, the way your customer would explain it to them. Explain the personal frustration and what would make this a sense of urgency for them. Then switch places. But leverage your partner. There's a lot of experience on this meeting. The person you're interacting with might hear something and say, well, did you mean this? Or would you say it this way? Leverage your partner. We're gonna take 6 minutes, so you gotta work fast. Walk it through, get some feedback. And then we'll come back. We'll have two or three people read theirs. So if you want a free commercial, when you come back, be prepared to come off mute and read yours so people hear what it is what you've got. Everybody good with that? Thumbs up. Everybody good with that?
Sure.
Got it? Perfect. Thank you. Go ahead, Ben, send them off. I know you guys are busy. I know there's a lot going on in your world. Right. And I'm sure I tell you that you got to do this for all three of your sides of customers, not just one. You're probably sitting there thinking, I don't have time. I got code I got to develop. I got to do this. I got to do that. I got to talk to an accountant, whatever it is. Here's my only caveat to you. We're going to give you some ideas of what to focus on today, but you got to take it and do something with it. Because frankly, if you don't get the sales and the customers right, a lot of the other stuff you're doing isn't going to matter as much. Right. So we're trying to give you enough to give you the whole process. And I warned you up front, so I'm not apologizing now that I I'm trying to pack a lot in. So, Drawer?
Yeah.
Talking because he keeps jumping on breakout. So he and I did a little bit of his. So tell the group what you came up with around the business pain, the personal impact, and that.
Well, I can describe it in the, what I'm looking for is a company leader, small company leader that just lost key personnel, very pissed off about it. He lost them to Silicon Valley because now everybody can work from home, so they don't even need to relocate. He's spending all his time on hiring instead of running the business and visioning the way forward. And this is costing a lot of money. So he is pissed, yeah. And we're gonna offer him a way to compete by, that's not part of it.
No, I don't. So part of the reason I wanted you guys to spend time on, yeah, everybody give him a round of golf clap, that was pretty good.
Thank you.
Right? Part of the reason I wanted you all to focus on the pains, either the business impact or the personal impact, is because what do we tend to do? What do typical salespeople tend to talk about? Man, I got this really neat app. And what the app does is it lets you do this and it lets you do that. And let me tell you about how many people we have developing code. Let me tell you about my features. Let me tell you about my benefits. When what you really want to focus on when you're thinking about your ideal client is, what are the real problems they face and how can you help them solve those problems, right? If you really want to define your client base well and connect with them, right, you have to know what's the real problem they're facing and be able to articulate it in a way that if they heard you say it, they'd go, oh, that's me. I got that one. That's my problem, right? So I'd encourage you as you work through your pain statements to put in as much words as you can about the specific prospect. So I promised a couple other people to give theirs. Anybody else want to share one? You have to come off mute to do it though. No? Is it because it's 10 to 5?
I'll share. Oh, okay, go ahead.
So my name's Danielle Osio, founder of Clupify. And so we are going after elephants. Because our target market is the electronics industry. So this would be an Apple, a Samsung, a Microsoft, those kinds of customers.
Okay.
And they would sound something like, oh no, these sustainability standards changed again. This is so frustrating. Every time that there's no new rules and regulations, we have to go back and I have to stop all the valuable work that I'm doing to develop new products and chase my suppliers and the internal colleagues to get all of this information to prove that I'm compliant with all of these new standards and regulations. I know I have to do it because if I don't, then I don't get access to over $4 billion of purchasing power. So an opportunity to make that money from sustainable purchasers. And so I need to do it as soon as possible. And
okay, who would you normally be talking to, Daniela?
Pardon?
Who would you normally be talking to?
A product manager.
Okay, so I get the business impact. They got a lot of work. They got very specialized work. They don't know how to figure it out. They don't want to take the time to figure it out, even though they're Apple, right? Yep. So they need somebody specialized that can figure it out for them. And it's complicated. It's messy. It takes a lot of time away from the time they should be spending developing product. Got it. What's that product manager's personal pain? Why do they care? They're getting paid, right? They're still getting paid.
Because they have to get that information no matter what. So, and it's usually not part of their like end strategy to be chasing after people to get all the evidence and doing all of that.
And what happens if they don't?
They'll probably lose their job.
So the person's real pain isn't that they need to know something they don't know. Their real pain is, geez, if I don't figure this out and keep developing more products, my boss is going to yell at me and I really like this cushy job I have with Apple.
Correct.
And I really don't want to go home and tell my spouse that I don't work there anymore because I didn't have a good answer to
So I couldn't, yeah, I couldn't manage it all.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Good. Go clap. Good. Again, that level of pain, that level of detail. Let's do one more. I heard one other person brave enough to talk up.
I can go if
anyone
else wants to. So my client is a deer client, small business client, locally based, been in business at least three to five years with a physical address, typically in the wellness health industry, consultants, professional services, those kind of businesses. So I'm typically talking to, depending on the size of the company, the founder, CEO, or a marketing lead. So the business pain here is there's high competition, they have low visibility, and you know how that works is if they can attract customers to their business, they won't be able to grow their business or gain market share in their industry. And so I think typically businesses think, my business is a marketing social media business. So I think small businesses, they typically think, you know, social media, Facebook, Instagram, that's free. We can just DIY this. When they realize that they're in the process of DIYing, but nothing's actually happened, they're like, oh no, we need to actually have photos and have a photographer and have write-ups and blog posts and SEO and paid and blah, blah, blah. And like, what's all this? Like they typically won't have someone on staff or a dedicated team to deal with all that, realizing that there is production equated with social media costs equated with it.
Got it. What's the real
business pain? The business pain is, again, like they won't be able to grow, attract customers in their competitive field, increase their visibility and stay in business and earn money, get bookings, get sales.
That's stay in business right there. 3 to 5 years in business, right? Most businesses.
Yeah. So they're small, looking to grow, but there's that barrier there. So you can't grow without having, you know, increasing your visibility online.
Okay. What's the CEO's personal problem?
He doesn't want to deal with it. He doesn't, like, what CEO is going to have time to be posting on Facebook and taking pictures or writing captions, researching hashtags?
Is that really his problem?
His problem is he needs to make money. He needs to stay in business. He wants to grow his business. He wants to not be in his business. He wants to be on the beach having someone else deal with this.
Somebody else in a couple of years. I got it. So when you're thinking about your ideal client, that deer, that professional health,
right? Yeah.
And you want to translate the ideal client. Think of those people that have that problem.
Yeah.
Right. Use the pain statements. You guys all keep, good job, by the way, another golf clap. Use those pain statements along with the other criteria that's in here to get a really good handle on who you're looking for. What is it I'm really looking for? Because what you're really looking for is that, not that person's in professional health for 3 to 5 years and his business is going through the roof, has more business than they know what to do with. You're looking for that one that says, where's all my business? And you have to know what you're looking for. So that's the first step, right? Know the right customer. Know who you're looking for. Know the pain you can solve. Second step in this prospecting mechanism, though, is where do I find them? Where do I find them? Now, there's a key point that I want to make right now that's really important to the rest of this discussion. And it's one that trips up a lot of people. There's two elements to prospecting. Now that you know what you're looking for, the next element is, where do I find them? And how do I go get them? How do I talk to them? Where I find them is a source. It's part of your preparation. It's part of your planning. Your prospecting is the actual action of getting a conversation. Don't confuse the two things. Planning and preparation is not prospecting. Making a cold call is prospecting. Okay? A lot of people get hung up on the planning and preparation piece. Go home at the end of the day after sending one email saying, man, I did a lot of prospecting today. No, You did a lot of preparation and plan. You didn't do a lot of prospect. Okay, so just don't get confused. The first part though is, where do you find customers? I'm gonna give you the cheat sheet, right? There's a number of places you can look for customers. You can look at your existing clients, right? They can either have more business that you don't have, right? So it's a new opportunity within an existing client, or they can be a source of referrals, right? So that's a place you can look for potential suspects or prospects. If you have clients that used to be clients and have left, maybe they have a new company, maybe they have a new need, a new issue you can take. Or maybe they're just ready to come back because whatever they left for you have now fixed, right? It's a place to look for prospects. You're dealing with a bigger company. Some of you talk about bigger companies. You're dealing with a bigger company that has multiple divisions. Looking in the broader company, looking for cross-firm, cross-company referrals is another way to find people, find sources of people, getting those referrals. Intermediaries or strategic alliances. I guarantee you on this meeting today, there is somebody in this meeting that could be a strategic alliance for you. Somebody that's calling on a similar kind of customer. Maybe your deer is their rabbit, but you're calling the same kind of person selling different things. They become an opportunity. They become a source for you, right? You can do prospecting stuff. You can get inbound, right? And you can hit every contact you know. Every one-to-one, you can call at me and say, Steve, I'm selling this. You know anybody that needs that? Anybody you have contacts with? Those are the sources for that. The key is, some of those sources are gonna make more sense for you. If you're brand new in business, going to past clients is gonna matter, right? Going to existing clients may not matter. Some of these sources are gonna be important for your business. You don't need to chase them all unless you're really struggling to find some. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to look at the list of seven. And for your business, take 15 seconds and pick four that you think hold the potential to have a lot of suspects or prospects. I do a lot with existing clients because I get a lot of referrals. I do a lot with strategic alliances because I have people that are calling on the same kind of people I am with a complementary type product. Okay, everybody got at least four? Now, of the four you pick the one you think is the most important, the one that could be the most influential to finding either your rabbits, your deers, or your elephant, right? I don't care which one it goes, pick one, I think could be most influential. Everybody got that? Okay, here's what I want you to do. And I'm gonna give you an example in a second, so hang tight. I want you to take a minute and translate that source into how would I go about leveraging that source for prospects? What am I gonna do to get more prospects from that source, right? I want you to think about what's my strategy, how am I gonna develop that target, and what are some of the actions I would take to get that, to make that work? So as an example, for me, I said I'd get a lot from existing customers. I get referrals. So as specific as I can, starting in August, I'm gonna talk to two clients a month for referrals. Sorry, my pen's acted up. The strategy is take some time and ask their permission to get the referrals from them, right? And there's a whole process for asking for a referral. We're not gonna go into that today. you want it, let me know, I'll shoot you a note. But I have a strategy that I'm going to talk to top clients. I'm going to talk about what's going on in their business, talk about what we've been successful doing, and who do they know that might be able to benefit from the same kinds of things. And so my plan is I'm going to create a list. That's prep work. I'm going to set up meetings with each of them. I'm going to practice. That's my prep work, right? Not prospecting yet. I'm prepping. I'm going to find out who I'm going to talk to. I'm going to set up meetings. And I'm going to practice how I'm going to ask for it. That's what I want you to do. In your breakout group, and you got groups of three. So you got 3 minutes per person. Use your breakout group to help you think through your strategy, your target, and as specific time bound as you can, the exact steps you're going to do. Right? I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do this. To prep and be ready to go after that source of prospects. Everybody got it? Thumbs up if you got it. I don't see, okay. I don't see any thumbs up, and I know I got to explain it some more. You got plenty of time. Work with your partner, get to know, talk about, this is the source I think I can get people from. Here's my approach. Here's the exact steps I'm going to take. If you're really bold, so for those of you that are really bold, make a commitment to the other two people in your breakout room and ask them to follow up with you based on the time commitment about how well you did. It's only for you guys that are really bold. All right, send them the breakout. You know what you're looking for. You know the right customer. You've thought about how do I prep and plan to go after them. The next question is, how do I put that into action? How do I put that into action? How do I make this work? So we use the term cookbook. Let me ask the group, what's in a cookbook? Anybody chat it in, what's in a cookbook?
Recipes, plans.
Recipes, thank you. recipes, right? And what makes a good recipe? Well, it has the prep work that you just worked on, right? What prep do I need? What ingredients do I need? More importantly, then, it's how do I cook it? How do I cook up the meal, right? Now, if you're anything like my house, we start planning our meals on Sunday. Sunday comes around, we plan out the next four meals. Friday's always pizza, so that doesn't need it. We plan out the next 4 days of what we're going to need. We go to the store on Sunday and buy all the groceries we need because we don't want to do that during the week, right? So we get our prep work done, get everything kind of ready. So that on Monday, when it's hamburgers, we just cook the recipe. The other thing a good recipe has in it is it tells you how many servings you're going to get, right? So it's not just what am I cooking, but it's how many servings do I need, right? And if you don't cook, you don't eat. So what I want you to think about is how do I take those plans, that preparation, that strategy you just talked about with one account that you're going to then do with all your other accounts, even though you're really busy, and put it into a template that allows you to focus on the behaviors. So David Radden, let me ask you a question. I'll pull you off mute. Since I know you, I don't have to be able to read your name. David, when you do a cold call, can you make the other person pick up the phone?
I cannot make the other person pick up the phone.
Okay, what can you control?
I can control the message that I leave for him when I reach the voicemail.
What else can you control in that cold call?
I can control when and how often I make that cold call.
Exactly. The challenge with prospecting for most people is we don't know what success is. So when we build our cookbook and we build our plans for prospecting, we focus on all the wrong things. We focus on the outcomes that we have no control over, somebody picking up the phone, instead of the behaviors, right? Now, taking it back to my cooking. I told Ben earlier, my wife had a broke her foot last week, so I'm doing all the cooking right now. I can't guarantee she's gonna like my cooking. In fact, I'm pretty sure I know what the answer to that is. But I can guarantee that I followed the recipe and made it the way I was supposed to. That's success in my book. That's success in prospecting. Did you make a plan and did you stick to it? Did you do what's in your control? Because if you do, that's a successful day of prospecting. So there's all kinds of different ways to prospect, right? I can cold call. Let's see. I can do networking. I can send LinkedIn emails. By the way, connections in LinkedIn, not really prospecting a whole lot. There's no real call to action. A LinkedIn email, different story, right? I can ask for referrals from colleagues and friends. I can email. I can do door knocking. I can ask for customers. I can follow up. I can cold call. I can pick a lot of different ways to prospect. Now, the prospecting is going to vary based on what am I going after, right? If I'm going after Apple, like Daniela was, right? I doubt she's going to do a door knock. I could be wrong, but I don't think you're walking, flying out there and knocking on the door and say, let me in, right? Conversely, if I'm like Doran, I'm working with small tech companies that have 50 people and they're local in the area. Maybe I do go do a door knock. There's going to be some prospecting activities that work for you and your business. The best prospecting activities, by the way, are the ones that you will do. So take a minute, look at this list and pick four. Pick four prospecting activities that work for your dear, whatever source you started with. What prospecting activities would help you make the conversation, have a conversation with those people? Just pick four. Now, what I would tell you is, if we had more time, I would tell you, pick four, but have three more in backup, right? Don't try to do more than four things at a time prospecting wise, but have other ones in case those don't work. Okay, you picked your four, maybe you picked an additional three. What's the next question that most people ask, do you think? What do you think is the next question most people ask? I got a prospecting activity. Let's say I mentioned I like to do, deliver free talks, right? Or no, I'll go with the one I mentioned earlier. Customer referrals. Going back to my plan, right? I said, I'm going to ask two clients a month. What most people start to then wonder is, how much do I need to do? How much prospecting do I need to do? Now, that's a complicated question. I'm going to give you a formula in your packet to think about. But if you're unsure, pick a number, pick an activity. I'm going to ask two, but also put it in how often I'm going to do it. So if you did your planning well, the next step is put it into a cookbook. I'm just leaving the screen for a minute so I can get somebody's face. Okay, Brad, start thinking of a song. Not Freebird, has to be less than 5 minutes. Start thinking of a song and has to be appropriate. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to make a commitment to yourself that you're gonna do prospecting. Because write your four down. Whatever four you're going to use. Then what I want you to do is put a frequency. The one we talked about a minute ago was referrals. right? How often am I going to do them? How many am I going to make? And this column is the key one. David, why is that one the key one? Why is that column the key one?
Because the number of times you do it creates more opportunity. And if you don't do it enough, you're not going to get them all. You're not going to be a winner on all of them. You're going to need to do it many times.
The key, yes, and it's all in my control. I can't force somebody to have a conversation with me. I can have a goal. I can have a goal. But what I can do is I can ask. I can ask 8 people for referrals. So what I want you to do is pick one of your 4, or do as many as you can. Pick a frequency that you're going to commit to yourself to do, how many you're going to do, and what you hope to get from it. Now, the target ultimately will tie back into the targets we did in the very beginning on a rabbit, deer, and elephant. But for now, give yourself a goal. If you don't have one, if you have one, great. If you don't, give yourself a goal. Brad, I gave you plenty of time. Pick a song.
Tom Petty, American Girl.
Tom Petty, American Girl. Okay, and I'll probably cut it short because I don't want to go over a lot of time. Alexa, play Tom Petty, American Girl, please.
And Steve, one of the questions in the chat is, can you better define intermediaries?
Can I better define intermediaries? Yeah, sure. Intermediaries are somebody that are connected to, think of strategic partners, think of people that are connected to your customer that you can connect to and become, they can become a conduit to your customer. So maybe you know a good CPA. He works with a lot of small businesses. You have a CPA firm that's a good, does a lot of small tech businesses. They're an intermediary that you can leverage to kind of get referrals and go on. They're not selling into that market necessarily the same way you are, but they're a connection through to it. Okay. Alexa, play Tom Petty, American Girl. And we'll cut you short on the songs. Alexa, pause. Okay, that was nowhere near 5 minutes. But just finish up one line. Make one commitment to yourself. I'm going to do this activity this often, and I'm going to do that number. Now, you're going to need to do that for all your prospecting activities, but make a commitment to yourself that that's what you're going to do. So what have we done? We've identified what the right customer looks like from a pain standpoint, where we might find them, how we prep and plan for them, and then how do we go about creating action and taking action and doing our behaviors. Far and away, if you can get that far, regardless of how many numbers you set, if you can live up to those behaviors, you're going to be more successful. I always get asked, how much should I do? It's a complicated question. If you want to get a sense of how to think about it, this is in your handout. I'm not going to go through it, but it seems basic. It gets more complicated as you dive into different ways to prospect. So let me give you some of the key traps that people fall into with this whole prospecting piece. One is they take it personally. Every time somebody tells you, no, I'm not interested, your world ends. Prospecting is a game. It's literally, is this a piece of straw or is this a needle? I don't care which one it is, I just need to know. Put your cookbook on your calendar. If you looked at my calendar right now, you'd see different colors for different activities. Put it on your calendar and treat it as if it was a meeting with a really important person, somebody that you would not skip out on, and treat it like a meeting. I can't tell you how many people don't put it on their calendar and never get around to it. Measure and adjust. Stay away from the squirrels. And remember what success is. Success is doing what you said you're going to do, not judging yourself on what kind of outcome comes from that. Let me end it there. So a couple quick follow-up points. We tried to give you a packet of information you could leverage. It's pretty straightforward. Know who you're chasing. Know where you can find them and plan for that, and then commit to doing the work. I know you guys are all busy. I know there's a lot going on. There's a lot of things you have to do. But if you don't get the selling part right, the prospecting part right, it gets really hard. And the simplest way to take pressure off is to have a big prospecting funnel. The bigger the funnel, the easier it is. My offer to you is, if you want to talk further about this, if you need a little help, you want to ask a couple questions and we didn't have time, put in chat, say, Steve, give me a call. Send me an email. We're going to send out stuff after class too. I'm happy to sit down with anybody and explain further details or just kick your ideas with you. I'm going to leave that offer there. So more than welcome to do that. And just open up to any real quick questions. We got like about 45 seconds. Any quick questions or anything you want to touch on?
Looking for a reference for direct digital marketing in Pittsburgh for a small startup company like myself.
You're looking for a digital reference, meaning somebody that can help you with digital marketing?
Digital marketing on social media, looking for a reference.
I think Aletha, isn't that?
I thought Aletha did that, but
yeah.
If that's not what she does, Brad, just shoot me an email. It's on the forms. I know a couple of different people that do that.
Okay, thank you.
That's certainly what I do. Happy to chat, happy go. To connect.
There you go, everybody.
I'm based in Toronto, if that's okay, but I'm happy to connect.
Okay, how do I connect? Is everybody's connection gonna be shared after this meeting, Steve? Yeah.
So we will be sending everybody a survey. So please tell us how we did. And, you know, this is one way for us to really take feedback and also put it back into how we design our upcoming sessions. And we will also share Steve's information in that email as well. So make sure that you'll get it right away, but make sure you fill out the survey and also connect with Steve if you have any follow-up questions. You can also send us an email to the sender team and you know, we will be happy to connect folks who want to be connected.
Great.
I put my email in the chat of that to make your life easier.
Okay, great, thanks.
There you go. Okay.
I did have a question.
So we were
talking about pain points and kind of speaking to customers' pain points. And so when we're cold calling or cold emailing, is that something that should be integrated into that email, into that draft? Like, do you directly kind of speak to that pain point? Like, I'm trying to make your life better so like your business can make money type of thing? Are you just kind of go for it? You just kind of get to the bottom line? Would you recommend or?
I do. I
would. Yeah.
Here's the thing, right? We all get thousands of emails a day.
Yeah.
the quicker we make a connection to that email, the more likely we are to respond to it, right? Do you think people are more likely to make a connection to reading some problem they have or some connection they have to the email? Or are they more likely to respond if they see features and benefits and kind of just what you do? Right? People are looking for relevance, right? When they get an email from you, they're looking for, how's this relative to me, right? Seeing their pains, things that they are actually experiencing, is going to be more relevant to them than whatever capabilities you feel like talking about. I had a guy cold call me yesterday, and I started to brush him off, and he said something about other Sandler people. And that was enough relevance for me to let him have 5 more seconds of my time, right? It's the same with emails. They have to feel like there's a relevance there. And they're not going to relate to your features and benefits. They're going to relate to the problems they have. I mean, there's a whole format for it. I'm happy to share it with you at some point, but at a high level, that's what it is.
Right.
I'm done talking, so it's up to you guys.
So we
can pick more music. I can.
Yeah, definitely. We can, since Steve, you know, we can hang out a little for a few minutes, but for those of you, the session is over. You know, sorry, we took a little bit more time, but to take the questions. But if you want, if you have any follow-ups, we'll be here for the next 5 more minutes.
Okay, thanks everybody. Appreciate your time. Thanks, Steve. Great job.